views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
Hey everyone, I'm the Dr. Bob Lee. Welcome to Open BXRX, another fantastic show in store for you. Coming up on today's show, we'll speak to a visionary, life coach, and author to learn about how her latest book bridges the gap between her past, present, and future. Then we'll check in with a licensed mental therapist, author, professional athlete, speaker, and founder of an organization that is helping others to become the best version of themselves. After that, we'll shine a light on an upcoming event that you don't want to miss. And Bobby C is here. He always has the latest in the world of sports. And then finally, we're here from a legend in the music and entertainment business who is being inducted into the Library of Congress. Stay tuned. All of this and more is headed your way. We are wide open. Here we go. Welcome, 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 welcome back, everybody, to Doc Bob Lee. And you're watching Open, that live interactive program that brings the Bronx and New York City straight to your TV set. Stay connected to us through social media at BronxNet TV. Now, leading things off, our first guest is a Chicago native, author, visionary leader, and speaker in learning innovations. She has also that community development and life coaching experience. So she's with us today to highlight her latest book, Bean Pie, a remembering of our family's faith, fortitude, and forgiveness. Please welcome to the show, Tiffany Green-Abdullah. Tiffany, welcome.
Good morning, Dr. Lee. Good morning. Thank you for having me.
Now, you look like you're sitting in a very, very cozy area, although it's, I can tell that you're from Chicago, but you're in Atlanta, mm-hmm. right?
Yes, yes, I am. Right now, broadcasting from the West End Park. Today is Eid al-Fitr, which is the commemoration of the end of Ramadan for Muslims. So
yes.
We just did our community prayer right out here. It's probably a couple thousand people walking around behind me.
Yeah, for those who don't know about Ramadan, explain it.
So Ramadan is the 30 days that Muslims fast during from sunup to sundown in order to, you know, it helps you strengthen your faith.
Yeah.
Understand what it's like to be poor, to be without, have compassion for the less fortunate. And so we fast from lots of different things, but food and water during from sunup to sundown.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. Listen, Tiffany, what is the inspiration behind this, the writing of the Bean Pie?
So, you know, I started writing through a book writing course right at the top of 2020. Kind of right before everything kicked off with you know what. And I was talking to my mother about the bean pie. So all my life I've been told that my great-great-aunt Daisy created the bean pie. And when I converted to Islam around 2009, I became more curious about the bean pie because I would see people at my mosque selling them.
Yeah.
I started making them. So originally the book was going to be just the origin story of the bean pie. But in conversations with my mother, the book got deeper in terms of like her childhood, her story, my grandmother's story,
wow.
as well as my great-great-aunt's story. So it's a multi-generational memoir of uh-huh. four African-American women starting in 1910 all the way to 2020.
Wow. So this bean pie was started in your family.
Yes, yes. I mean, and I have been researching for years, putting it all together, the story.
Mm-hmm.
But yes, my great-great, my second great-aunt, Daisy, created the bean pie through her little restaurant eatery in Detroit, Michigan. She was one yeah. of the earliest members of the Nation of Islam.
So it's a wonderful thing that you're documenting this whole thing. You know, are you going to maybe
yes.
try to get into like a documentary or film?
You know, I'm talking to a good friend of mine who's an entertainment lawyer in New York, and talking about a television series, actually.
Look at that. There you go. Hey, you never know. Mm-hmm. You never know where it's going to go. You know.
You never know.
Now you're in it. Why was it so important for you to share your family story?
You know, being part of the Black Muslim community, I kept doing research and trying to figure out the origin story of the bean pie. And my family was sitting right in the center of it. And there was no documentation of the true history of the bean pie. So it was sort of that assignment, right?
Yeah.
And that assignment that I decided to take up. And 2 years later, I had a 330-page book written. This is my my early copy that I write in. But, you know, that was really the inspiration. And telling the story, it wasn't really even about the book. It was about telling my children the story and telling my cousins and my nieces and nephews about who their story, who their family is, and reclaiming our legacy as it relates to the bean pie.
But wait, Tiffany, if your aunt has that great recipe from the bean pie, what else does she have?
Well, she was known for making the bean soup and the bean pie. I actually make both. I make both, and I sell the bean pies. Yes, I sell my book.
So that recipe passed down through generation, right? Through the generations?
Yes. So I didn't have the exact, like, on paper recipe, but I made my version of the bean pie through my mother's taste buds. She would keep tasting it and tasting it until I got it right. And I would bring her some, you know, from my mosque, and she would say, no, ours is a little different. It's not so wet. You know, and I would just keep tweaking it until she said, that's it. That's what I remember. Yeah.
I've eaten many of them. Now, where can we go?
I'll send you one.
Yeah, thank you. Where can we go to get yours? Are you, you're all the way in Atlanta. I gotta travel out to Atlanta.
I am in Atlanta. You can come whenever you come here. I will definitely make you some bean pies. But my website is thebeanpie.com. So if people are local, they can order on my website, and we just figure out how to get it to them. I'm not at the point where I can legally ship pies to people. Yeah. They can get the book on Amazon, and they can get as well as thebeanpie.com.
That's right. When I take my little trip out there to South Carolina, I'll go to Atlanta, and I'll visit the radio station out there, 103, and then I'll give you a call and say, hey, you know, I'm in town. And if you give me some bean pies,
let me know when you're coming.
They won't make it back to South Carolina.
Look, I made three last night for the breaking of fast, and I think there is half of one pie left.
Yeah.
Oh, and it's five people in my house.
Oh, yeah. So that's gone.
Yeah.
What message would you like readers to take away from your book?
The message is that, you know, I wrote this book really as remembrance, as activism, because right as I was writing this book, everything was going on, right, with George Floyd, the protests, right at the sort of the heart of when I was writing and crafting a manuscript.
Yeah.
And I wanted my family's, you know, legacy to be remembered. And, you know, the fact is all of us have stories. All of our grandmothers, great aunts all have incredible stories. That the reason why you and I are even sitting here today is because of them.
Yeah.
Right. And so we have to tell our stories. And I really believe in Sankofa, which is looking back for the things we lost so that we can look forward to the future. Yeah. And that future in my family includes the bean pie and retaking and reclaiming that legacy in terms of a industry and elevating the bean pie out into the world as a culinary delicacy, a true Black American culinary tradition that's truly American, as well as, you know, the other things that my family is working on in terms of being, you know, in business and such.
Yeah. Tiffany, where can we go to get more information on what you're doing?
You can go to my website, thebeanpie.com, as well as you can purchase the book on Amazon under The Bean Pie, A Remembering.
Tiffany, thank you so much. Thanks for sharing, okay?
Thank you so much for having me, Dr. Lee.
And good luck with everything. I know you got another part two coming up. Tiffany Green-Abdullah, author Bean Pie. She's got that book out there, Remembering Our Family's Faith, Fortitude, and Forgiveness. We're going to take a quick break right here. I've got more open coming your way. Don't move. Welcome back. I'm the Doc, Bob Lee from 107.5 WBLS. You're watching Open. Now, next guest is a successful multi-entrepreneur. She's a licensed mental therapist, speaker, and the owner of and founder of Balance Wellness Collective and Ascension Mentality. She's here to join us to speak about the importance of mental health and how she helps others become the best version of themselves. So please welcome to the show, Amy Wilhelmi. Amy, welcome.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Amy, how did you get involved in all of this? It seems like to get involved in something so close to a person, you really have to be in it for some time. Tell us about it. How did you get involved?
Yeah, so I've been licensed clinically for about 10 years. I own a large mental health that's called Balance Wellness Collective.
Yes.
I employ about 10 licensed therapists. So that's that business. And then essentially I'm writing a book. I'm doing lots of speaking events all over the world. I'm really focusing on mindset and mentality and can do for people in their lives. So
now, do you coach athletes or you're an athlete yourself?
Both. So I specifically work with athletes, with trainer teams in general. I am a bodybuilder. So I do women's bikini division.
There you go. All right. Do you help out women or men also?
I do both. So I work specifically with the athlete mentality, whether they're feeling like stuck. Sometimes athletes are injured or sidelined and they're not able to do what they're trained to do, right? So they're in that stuck place. They don't really know what the next steps are. Mm-hmm. So I specifically work with that. And then also there's another thing that happens in an athlete's life when they're thinking about retiring or they have retired and they're kind of like, now what? What the heck do I do with my life
after
entire time doing my sport? So those are my niches in the world of athletes.
Yeah. So people get stuck during that time when they find out that they have to retire that I guess that can be a big problem, right? What I've been doing this all of my life, I've been using my body, but where do I go from here? What's next?
Yeah, I mean, you experience loss. You have to work through this phase of like uncertainty and confusion, right? It's kind of a grief. Sometimes their relationships get a little bit messed up because it's really the core loss of identity, right? You're like so direct oriented and focused, and then suddenly that's gone. So again, it's like I work specifically with athletes that are injured or maybe not able to perform or are at that next stage where they're thinking about retiring. Vent themselves. It's a pivot.
And this is all within Ascension Mental?
Yeah, Ascension Mental is the athlete coaching. Now, I coach individual athletes on this mentality, and then I also do presentations for teams. So, youth teams, college teams, and everything in between. So, a lot of my speaking engagements are with those teams, and then my coaching is with the athletes themselves. And, you know, it's completely confidential, just like therapy. I think sometimes mental health is still, to this day, has a stigma.
Yeah, people need, you need to see someone, you know. But when you talk about mental health, you're absolutely right. There is a stigma attached to it. You know, people are going to find out that I went to see somebody, they're going to think I'm crazy, I'm nuts. But no, you know, I think people need, if you really, really need it, you need to go see somebody and just iron some things out.
Right, just work through it. I mean, I wish, like, you go to the gym, you try to eat healthy, you should go to your therapist and kind of work through some of that stuff too, so you're not feeling stuck, you're not in that bad place. So
yeah. So tell us, how has COVID-19 impacted the mental health therapy as far as you working with people? I know a lot of people got stuck on that, and people are still going to be suffering from TPST associated with the mental health, associated with the COVID-19, basically.
Yeah, I think the biggest impact, obviously, has been the isolation that people have experienced, right? They're not used to being so isolated. We're kind of social beings, so that's been really difficult for everybody's mentality and mental health. I think what it did do in a positive light for mental health is kind of this, being able to connect more normally with people that are all over the world. I think that luckily the insurance companies kind of kicked in and said, oh, we can switch to telehealth and get people what they need. So the telehealth industry of mental health and doing it, you know, via video or phone has kind of exploded, which is good because it's helped people. You know, I see clients over the world.
Yeah.
So.
Hey, Amy, how did you get into competitive bodybuilding and what have you learned from it?
Yeah. So I like a good challenge, right? I kind of went through my own ascension journey. I'm actually...
Yeah.
Now it's called Ascension Mentality. The first book just came out called Making Mental Gains. I needed a challenge. I needed something to work towards. And so I started doing it. I hired a trainer. I travel. I'm with a team. But really what it's done for my lifestyle is kind of this huge overhaul, right? So, I mean, you have to be incredibly dialed and incredibly focused and organized.
Yeah, so basically you tested it on yourself. You tested it out on yourself.
I did. I think, you know, I'm also a mom. So I have a blended family. I have five children. We have five children all together. So I needed something for me as well besides work. You know, I needed a hobby. I needed something that just was a passion of mine that had nothing to do with work or being a mom.
And this is also a therapy for you.
Oh, incredibly therapeutic. Yeah. I mean, I know that my rest days are necessary, but I don't love them. Like I love the adrenaline, consistency, and, you know, what happens in the gym and on a daily basis.
Great, great. Where can we go to find out more about Amy?
Yeah, so my website is www.amywilhelmi.com.
Give that to me one more time.
Yes, it's www.amywilhelmi.com. And the book is on sale on Amazon. It's called Making Mental Gains.
Gotcha. Amy, thank you so much. It was a pleasure talking to you, and you're always welcome to come back.
All right, thank you.
All right, thank you. Amy Wilhelmi, founder, Balanced Wellness Collective and Ascension Mentality. Thank you, thank you, thank you. We'll take a quick break right here, and we'll come back and give you a whole lot more next.
We built a media network for you.
BronxNet TV.
Come learn in your new state-of-the-art studios at Lehman College.
At Mercy College.
And coming soon to the South Bronx in the Hub.
Inspire with your stories, culture, history.
Your Bronx on BronxNet.
Engage with us.
Connect with us at your channels and at BronxNet.tv.
Learn, engage, inspire. BronxNet TV.
From the Bronx
to the world.
BronxNet.
Thank you.
And welcome back. Our next guest is no stranger to the show. She's been here before, and she's the executive director of the Van Cortlandt Park Alliance, and we'll be speaking to her about their Springtime Fete and much, much more. So please welcome to the show, Stephanie Ehrlich. Stephanie, how are you?
I'm great. How are you?
Nice to see you again.
Nice to see you, always.
Yeah, you guys are always doing something over there, and we love it. You know, when you're doing something, we want to get involved too.
Excellent.
So what's going on? What inspired the creation of this Springtime Fete?
So we have lots going on in the park. Van Cortlandt Park, as you know, is the best park in the Bronx. You know, and I'm not biased or anything.
No, all right. Woo! There you go. You're not biased?
No. Sorry?
No. So go ahead.
Okay. Okay. Is that good?
Yeah.
Okay. So we have our Springtime Fete, which is our annual benefit that benefits the park. We are in collaboration and partnership with NYC Parks. We help maintain the park. So Van Cortlandt Park Alliance raises funds, and we are actually going to have a fete, which is the same as a fiesta. A party. And there will be salsa dancing. Woo! And lots of yummy snacks. And we are honoring two amazing women. We are honoring Sonia Manzano, who folks may know better as Maria from Sesame Street.
Oh.
She is the Bronx. Yeah, she is the Bronx's own, and she is just an absolute delight. And I'm a fangirl, so when I met her, I was like, you know, my inner 7-year-old was like, oh my God, it's Maria. It was very exciting. And then, of course, we are honoring one of our very own, Iris Rodriguez Rosa, who was the Bronx Borough Commissioner for NYC Parks, has been recently elevated to be First Deputy Commissioner for the organization. So she is the number two person at NYC Parks, and we could not be more proud and more excited. We're sad we don't get to see her every day, but our loss is the city's gain.
Yeah.
And so we are celebrating her as well. And she's receiving a special award that has now become an annual tradition. It is the Betty Campbell Adams Park Angel Award.
Wow.
And Betty, as you may know, Betty, who was the owner of Lloyd's Carrot Cake, who we lost sadly in December of 2020. Very, very sad. We honor her because she was a park angel. She loved Van Cortlandt Park, and her family continues to support us. Her kids, Lilka and Brandon, are very, very involved in the park. So so we have this amazing award in her memory.
Well,
so Iris will get that.
Yeah, and she's still the park angel.
She is the park angel.
Yes.
She's looking over us, you
yes,
know?
Yes. So tell us, the attendance for this year, how did that look?
It's looking good, but we still have tickets available. So tickets are $250 each, which may seem a little steep, but it is a fundraiser. It does help us and benefits the park directly. Every dollar benefits the park directly. So we hope that folks will take out a ticket. Or if you'd like to send a message to Iris, you can do that. We have kind of a fun, it's not a journal, it's kind of a scroll, and she'll get to hang that up in her new office. So those messages are really inexpensive. You can go to our website, vancortlandt.org.
Yeah.
Don't forget to spell it right with a T at the end, vancortlandt.org, and you can get some ads, or you can buy tickets or sponsorships. So we've got barefoot dancing, which is super fun. We've got music and dancing happening on May 4th and June 1st. So please, that's free, and you can join us and have a great time. We love music. We love to dance. We're also going to have a Juneteenth event on June 20th, which is Monday, the new federal holiday. There will be music and readings and a libation ceremony. We are doing that in partnership with our good friends, Bronx Arts Ensemble. It will be beautiful. This is our second annual event. There will be movies this summer out on the parade ground, and
right.
I am cooking up something crazy.
Wait, so what are you cooking up? What are you cooking up? You didn't say what it was. What is it?
There will be a DJ.
We want the inside scoop.
There will be a DJ. There's going to be all kinds of fun things. Maybe you'll come in costume. I don't know. We like a party in the park. So
yeah.
July 14th, 28th, August 4th and 11th. So look for that on our website, and we'll tell you what those movies are. They're going to be fun, fun, fun. And then, of course, volunteer with us. Please volunteer with us. We need all the help we can get. We cannot do what we do without you. So we have Trail Work Wednesdays. We have Forest Fridays. Come on down to the park. Again, vancortland.org is the place to find it all out. And you can follow us on social media at VCP Alliance.
I love it. A lot of things going on in the park. Party in the park. Here we go.
In the park,
so
yes.
What is the date of the fete? Say it again.
But out by 10 o'clock.
Yeah. What is the date? I know. What is the date by the of the fete?
May 19th.
May 19th. And your website again is?
VanCortlandt.org, and you can actually see it there on the right, on the bottom right corner under the swans, VanCortlandt.org.
There you go. So if we want to volunteer or send money or get involved, VanCortlandt.org. Don't forget to put the T
it's
at the
place.
End. Yeah. Stephanie, thank you. We love you, and thanks for sharing.
Thank you. Thanks, Dr. Bob.
All
see
right.
You.
There you go.
Have a great day.
Stephanie Ehrlich, Executive Director of VanCortlandt Park Alliance. We'll take a quick break, but Bobby C is up next. He has the latest in the world of sports. Make sure you check that out next.
Last time out, we spoke with Fordham's Nick Sakel about realizing his NFL dream. Here's part two of that interview. I'm going to have my my editor and co-producer, Chris Pusateri, flash a bunch of graphics because it would take me forever to read all of the accolades that you've collected the last 4 to 5 years at Fordham. But I think the couple that definitely stand out are all Patriot League for 4 seasons, and then one of just 24 players in league history to earn All-League all 4 years, Lansing Trophy and Cosida Academic All-District. We mentioned it before with the high school days. I mean, in your opinion, how valuable was it during this draft process to talk to these NFL teams and for them to know that you're not just a smart guy when it comes to football, but also an academic All-American?
I definitely think it's a huge advantage for me, especially kind of with Fordham having the academic esteem that it does, kind of knowing that I was able to be successful in the classroom there. I think that it just shows the testament of just kind of my work ethic that just kind of shows on the field and off the field. So kind of being able to succeed in the classroom at Fordham with especially a tough school. I think just being in New York City with all the great connections they have, that was something that I really looked forward to when I was committed to the school and kind of first came here. So I definitely think that was a positive in many teams' eyes, just because it shows that even for the center part, you have the intelligence to play at that position, kind of being able to read defenses, make calls and all that. So I definitely think that helps me a lot.
Nick, you're a finance major. So did some of the mindset coming into this was, well, you know what, I aspire to be a pro player, but if nothing else, maybe I can fall back on this great Fordham business education.
Of course. I think that's the main reason I went to Fordham is that I didn't initially go, okay, I'm going to play 4 years here and go in the NFL. I initially thought just that, okay, I'm going to play 4 years here, get a great education, and then hopefully get a great job, which I think that definitely serves as a nice fallback plan, especially with my having completed my master's in business analytics too. That's something that I really enjoyed taking all those classes, learning so much about kind of different data styles and all that, kind of how to research it, how to kind of interpret it, visualize it, and all that. It was a great experience at Fordham. And so I think that just definitely serves me in my best interest going forward. Because I think that a lot of things that coaches said when they're recruiting us, it's not a four-year plan, it's a 40-year plan. So I definitely think that with my degrees from Fordham, it really puts me in an advantageous position going forward.
No, definitely a great fallback. But more importantly, we get a chance to live dreams here in the Bronx because now you're going to the NFL. We got a chance to see that clip before when you talked to the Niners after the draft. And, you know, I know one of the great stories that came out of this, and I think maybe the people at home could not possibly really understand what it's like, A, to be drafted, but also that waiting process. And I remember you saying that, you know, even though you knew it was coming or you thought it would be coming, that as those picks started to kind of pile up and you were a little concerned, a little worried about it.
Yeah, definitely. I just think that you just kind of have the worst situations playing through in your head. It's like, okay, as the sixth round started, I really just thought, okay, I might have a chance of going undrafted here. I actually had texted my agent. He kind of just checked in and said, okay, how are you feeling? I'm like, honestly, like, not great. Like, just kind of waiting. He's like, okay, like, there's a lot of picks to go. And I think it was about 2-3 minutes later, I got the call from the Niners. So that was just such a surreal feeling. And I was able to kind of all that waiting, all that hard work kind of ended up working out in the end.
And that Santa Clara number rings on the phone, and it's got to be pretty cool to pick up and talk to guys like Kyle Shanahan and John Lynch, who of course was such a great NFL player as well.
Of course. Yeah. Really great experience. I'm glad to be able to part of that.
Yeah, I mean, to me, I want to get your thoughts on the Niners. I mean, they had a pretty good year last year, and I think there's only more room for growth, and they've got some really talented young players. Give us a little bit of a forecast of what you expect to see from the Niners this year, especially since you'll be in the trenches.
Of course. I think just that making their way through the playoffs last year, I think just that with a lot of guys returning as well, I just think that really poised to kind of make that run again. I think that just kind of really starts in camp. I'm really excited to be a part of it and kind of just can't wait to see where this team's able to go.
You mentioned it earlier too, because I really do think that now Fordham has become a destination for a lot of NFL scouts to roll through. I mean, the last couple of years, it almost seemed, Nick, like week in and week out that there was a scout, whether it be at games at home or on the road, to see some of the players at Fordham. I was curious if you could give me some insight into some of your teammates, because I think Ryan Greenhagen will get drafted at some point if he can stay healthy and get into that process, because he's also been excellent academically. He's someone that we had on the show at some point. And then Tim DeMorat is a guy that, you know, physically as well, like you, looks like he can play the position in the league. Your thoughts on those two guys and any of the other guys on the Fordham roster that you might see in the NFL at some point?
Of course, Ryan and Tim are two of the hardest working guys I've kind of met. And I think this kind of really shows the success they've had in the field. And I definitely think that Fordham football is in great hands, in their hands going forward. I think that they'll be able to lead both sides of the ball to have a lot of success next year. I think that there's a lot of supporting cast members, I think, that deserves looks as well. Phil Sala, Fotis Kokosoulis, I think those guys are going to be really successful going forward, whatever they do. I think that I can't wait to see what all those guys are able to do on the field come next year.
Is there a best moment that stands out from the, you know, from this 5-year period, these four seasons?
I'd probably say there's a couple. I mean, obviously I mentioned prior, I think that my first start against Central Connecticut was something that was really special to me, just because I wasn't really expecting to play much my freshman year. And then come the second game of the year, I got my first start. So that was something that was really special. I think the win against Richmond at home in 2019, I think, was again a really special really great win for us, just because against a CAA opponent at home, I think that was just something that I'm really able to look back on. I think that that was a great game to be a part of, really proud of how our team did that day. And I think just the Nebraska game in total, I think that's that not many people are able to play in those great situations for an 85,000. I think that there's just so much to take away from that game. It was a great thing to be a part of. And obviously I'm kind of going through a bunch of these moments, but there's countless and countless moments I can go on. It just kind of shows the immense pride I have in kind of being a part of this Fordham football program, kind of being able to really use it to kind of be a part of it, kind of show others that I was a part of them. I think that I'm really excited to kind of see where this program goes in the future.
Is there a message that you might pass on to youth here in the Bronx and around the city and maybe even around the country when it comes to maybe being overlooked and what the what's required, I guess, to step up and rise to doing bigger and better things?
Of course. I just think that it all comes down to hard work in the end. I think that if you're able to put your head down and really get kind of just work as hard as you can and kind of really obviously get opportunities here and there, take advantage of whatever may come. And I think that there's no opportunity too small that matters. I think kind of obviously not many people go to Fordham and go to the NFL, but I think that through hard work and kind of dedication and really just kind of putting my head down, I think that I was able to achieve some success in that way. I think that a lot of other people are able to as well.
Nick, there were some people, though, that, you know, I would say doubters even, right? Like, you know, you see some of this material that gets put out for the draft and they'll come out and they'll say like, well, you know, he might be fourth, fifth, sixth round pick. He'll be an average tackle in the NFL. I mean, is that stuff that you put on the bulletin board and say like, all right, you know, I'm going to make this guy pay when I get to the league?
Obviously not really. I just try not to pay attention to it. The good or the bad, I think that it's all just kind of just really content on the internet. So I think that's something that all I can worry about is how I'm performing at this level. And so I think that kind of putting myself in the best position to succeed, whether that's working out, kind of getting in shape, just making sure I know my playbook, all that. Those are things I worry about.
And Nick, even though I know home is Ohio, Cleveland, and now will be San Francisco, is there going to be something that you're going to miss about the Bronx? And will you come back to Fordham at any point?
I have to miss Arthur Ave. I think just kind of the great restaurants, great Italian food on that place. I think that's something that I will definitely have to return to in the future. Just kind of get a part of that again.
Definitely easy to be 325 pounds when you hang out at Arthur Avenue, my friend.
Of course, of course.
Well, we definitely wish you the best of luck. I mean, so excited to see you get drafted in the NFL and to watch you play all of these years at Fordham. It's been an honor. And, you know, keep up the good work and keep up the smarts, because I think that's what makes a great NFL player, someone that the teams can count on both mentally and physically.
Thank you. Appreciate that. We'll be right back.
welcome back, everybody. Our next or last guest is a legend in the world of music. She's a biggie in the entertainment industry. She's a member of the Shirelles, ladies and gentlemen, the first all group in the rock and roll era. So we'll speak to her about her storied career, highlight her induction into the Library of Congress, and much, much more. So please welcome to the show, Beverly Lee. Is that my sister? Beverly, welcome.
Yes. Hello, my brother. How are you?
All right, my sister. Listen, you've been doing so many wonderful things, and I know you're going to get ready to get back out there and hit the road again. And the road is a tough thing, but can you just tell us what it means to be inducted into the Library of Congress?
I am so honored. When I got the news, there were 25 people that were inducted, and we're in the class with Nat King Cole, Duke Ellington.
Woo.
Hank Aaron, Alicia Keys, there's Bonnie Raitt, and also, Nat King Cole, did I say Nat King? It's a small world.
You said
world,
Nat King Cole.
Williams.
Yeah.
Yes, and Four Tops.
Wow. That's really, really big. So that really feels good, huh?
Yeah, you know, I'm so glad that they're giving us our flowers while we're alive.
Of course, yeah. And also often they wait until afterwards to posthumously induct them into this and that and that. But you're also in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, the members of the
Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, the New Jersey Hall of Fame, now the 2022 class of the National Registry. So
yeah.
God is blessing us.
Yes, you are blessed for sure. And ladies and gentlemen, if you just tuned in, of course, some of the songs that the Shirelles have put out, Soldier Boy, Will You Still Love Me Tomorrow, Dedicated to the One I Love, and Mama Said. And so many people did these songs over after you guys put it out. There were a number of groups that said, you know, let's cover this.
Yes, Dionne Warwick did, Linda Ronstadt.
And so many others, yes.
The Beatles, Ringo Starr.
Yeah. Now, you've traveled the world, Beverly. And you've seen so many wonderful things. You've performed for just about everybody. What are some of your fondest memories?
Well, our music has taken us to 5 continents. And some of my fond, there's so many. I enjoyed doing a concert for the Kennedys at Ethel Kennedy's home. We've done an inaugural ball for President Bush. We worked for President Carter, for President Johnson. Our first time at the Apollo Theater, working with all the idols that we listened to on the radio. Mm-hmm. Chuck Berry, Coasters and the Drifters and the Anthony and Imperial.
Wow.
So it's been a blast. And traveling with Dick Clark, there are a lot of stories to pick one. And they'll be in my book.
So there's a lot of them that stuck out in your mind, right? It's not one, because you've been doing this for a while.
It's all in the book.
Yeah, and let's talk about that book. You wrote what's the name of the book?
Will You Love Me Tomorrow?
Ah!
Yes.
Will you still love me tomorrow? Now listen.
Yep.
Don't try to get me to sing it. I'm an announcer. But I'll try to mess around.
It was a great song written by Carole King. You know, when we first heard the song, it sounded like a country and western song, very twangy, and Carole was singing on it.
Uh-huh.
And Luther Dixon was our A&R man. He was producing us. He said, you know, you're going to do this song.
Yeah.
And when we went into the studio, it was a totally different arrangement, very lush, strings and harps, cellos, you name it.
Yeah.
And Carole was there at the session. She didn't like what the percussionist was playing, so she's playing kettle drums on Will You Still Love Me Tomorrow.
Yeah. So did they just change it up right there in the studio for you?
Oh, no. When we got there, that's when we heard the new arrangement.
Oh, okay.
And we fell in love with it.
And then, boom, a big hit. Bam. Just like that.
Yes, Lord.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, that was our first million seller, Will You Still Love Me Tomorrow.
See? That's a beautiful thing. Give us a quick synopsis of what's in the book.
There's a lot of history. There's a lot of inspiration. There's a lot of short tales, what went on the bus tours and behind the scenes, the different theaters, because we did the Chitlin' Circuit, the Apollo, the Uptown in Philly, the Royal in Baltimore, Chicago, the Regal, and the Howard in Washington, D.C.
Yeah. You said, did you mention the Apollo Theater?
Yes. That was the first one I mentioned, the Apollo.
Ooh, shucks. I've hosted at the world-famous Apollo Theater for some time. We did amateur night there. We had a lot of fun, and I know a lot of people have come through and touched that piece of log on there, on that stage.
Yes.
To signify that, you know, we went out, we toured, we came back, and our love and luck is still continuing.
That's
right. A beautiful thing. Yeah. So what's next for you?
Well, I'm hoping behind the book that I'll get some offers to do some kind of documentary, biopic series of some nature. I plan on writing a musical play.
Ooh, all right.
There's a lot on my plate.
Yeah. Beverly, who would you want to play you?
Regina King.
Ooh, okay. Did you speak to her about it yet? Give us the inside scoop.
Not yet.
Well, she's going to see this and give you a call.
Oh, yeah.
She's going to say, Beverly, I heard you've been trying to reach out to me.
And I'll tell her I'm available.
There you go. So that was the greatest hit from the Shirelles?
Oh, yeah.
Will You Still Love Me?
Then we had Soulja Boy sold over 15 million copies.
Yeah.
And that was the anchor to many loved ones who were part of the time. And then we had Dedicated to the One I Love. It was recorded by the Five Royals first.
Yeah.
And we heard them sing it so much at the Howard Theater that we sang it constantly. And Florence Greenberg, who owned Accept the Record, said, why don't you record it? And we did our version of it.
Yeah.
Then we had Mama Said. We had Tonight's the Night. We had Baby It's You, the Burt Bacharach and Hal David song.
Yeah. Yeah, I have a lot of those. I told you I have that whole collection. I have a lot of those records there.
And we were blessed to have people like Sam Cooke write songs for us and produce us, and Ashford and Simpson.
Uh-huh. Wow. And, you know, Smokey did one of your songs, too, didn't he? Didn't he do one of his songs over?
I think so. And then we went in when Dionne Warwick re-recorded Will You Still Love Me Tomorrow. Luther Vandross asked us to do the backup.
Yeah.
The songs for her.
Yeah. Do you have any shows booked where we can come and see you?
Well, they're not around here, but I will let you know when we're going to be in the area.
Yeah, don't worry. I'll travel. I'll jump on I need a flight. Where am I going?
We'll let you know.
Okay.
Just have your bags ready.
All right. I got one down here. See? I'm ready for you.
Okay.
Listen, thank you for all that you're doing. Thank you for all the wonderful music over the years. We love you. We appreciate you. Give our love to, I think there's one other member that's still with us, right?
Shirley Reeves, yes.
She retired?
Yes.
And God bless the other two members that traveled with you so many times around the world. You know, we appreciate you, Beverly.
Thank
and we
so
love
much.
Say it again.
I said, thank you so much.
Yeah. We appreciate you and we love everything that you're doing. And congratulations, the Library of Congress. Woo! There we go.
I am thrilled.
Yeah. And congratulations also on the brand new book.
Yes.
And that name of that book is Will You Love Me Tomorrow?
That's right.
All right. Do you have a website that we can go to?
Well, you'll be able to reach us at the ShirellesOfficial.com. There's ShirellesOfficial.net.
Mm-hmm.
Official.org.
I have one question, one last question. Will you still love me tomorrow?
Of course. Whatever.
I love you, Beverly. Thank you so much.
I love you too. God bless you.
God bless you too. All right. That about does it for us right here. Beverly Lee from the Shirelles. Thank you so much for tuning in. Thank you so much for checking it all out. I'm the Dr. Bob Lee. And we want to thank the crew for putting us all together, our BronxNet crew. And always remember this, what you are is God's gift to you. What you make of yourself is your gift to God. So choose your choice and let your choice control the chooser. Remember, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And I'll catch you another day, another way. I'll see you over 107.5 WBLS. Love you all. Peace.